going to talk today about crime. I love crime. Crime novels, that is. And behind me are a series of contemporary novels from some very, very famous writers of today. Elmore Leonard, Sue Grafton, James Lee Burke, and Wamba. They follow in the footsteps of what I call the great triad of crime novelists. The great triad was Raymond Chandler, Dashiell Hammett, and James M. Cain. And the titles of their works are quite familiar. Raymond Chandler wrote The Big Sleep. Dashiell Hammett wrote The Maltese Falcon. And James M. Cain, among other things, wrote The Postman Always Rings Twice. And those movies are still being made and remade. And I was introduced to crime fiction when I was 6 or 7. I was listening to a radio show. The character, the name of the show was The Adventures of Sam Spade. Well, Sam Spade was a creation of Dashiell Hammett. And he had a radio show, a very successful show, and Mother and I were listening to The Adventures of Sam Spade, the Hammett character, on the radio. And this would have been around 1946, perhaps. I was 7 or 8. And so she let me listen to all these radio shows. And anyway, the beginning of the Sam Spade thing usually had Sam talking about what was going on with the case and so forth and so forth. Sometimes he'd have an interchange with his secretary, Effie. And so in this particular case, Effie started the conversation, which was unusual. So Effie said, Sam, Lieutenant so-and-so called, and he has to hear from you right away. It's very urgent. And there was a fairly long pause, and finally Sam said, screw him. Only he didn't say screw. Another pause, and Effie said, well, and Mrs. So-and-so wants to know what you've done about such and such. Long pause. Screw her too. Followed by another long pause. Silence followed by music, which was the rest of the show, actually, because what had happened is Howard Duff had gotten loaded between, my mother explained this to me, got loaded between the Eastern broadcast, which was 3 hours earlier, and the Western broadcast, which was 3 hours later. He had gone to the nearest bar, and that's what happened. Well, anyway, that leads us into what has been called the perfect movie, The Maltese Falcon. That's kind of strange in a way, because The Maltese Falcon, a property owned by Warner Brothers since 1930, was actually made 3 times. The first time with an actor prominent at the time named Ricardo Cortez, and he was Sam Spade, and nobody wanted to see it. And then they made it as a comedy and called it Satan Was a Lady, and Warren William, another forgotten star of the time. Anyway, it bombed. Nobody wanted to see it too. So it really is a tribute to the strength and length of affection for this character, Sam Spade, that they attempted to do it again. And that was in 1940. This was started to put together, 40, 41. And this assembled, and Warner Brothers, like all the studios, made 50 films a year. A lot of them were schlocky. Some of them were okay. And some of them were really great. But as I say, The Maltese Falcon has been called the perfect film. And one of the reasons was it had such an impeccable cast. Humphrey Bogart, Sidney Greenstreet, Peter Lorre, Mary Astor, Gladys George, Elisha Cook Jr., Barton McLean, Ward Bond, and on and on and on. Even the one speaking, one-liner people in this picture were really good. And nothing could top it. The look of it, the sound of it. Now, how was it made? Well, John Huston wrote the screenplay by copying the book almost word for word. he eliminated a superfluous character, maybe two of them, but it was basically the same show. It just was better in every way. It may have been the first film noir that people love, that film noir, you know. It really violated lots of the codes of the time, and it did it in such a way that nobody seemed to catch it. For example, Sam was fooling around with his partner's wife, who was fooling around with everybody, including the first client that comes in, Mary Astor, and he hustles her while Sam is trying to do a deal and find this missing sister, who didn't exist, by the way. And so the Maltese Falcon, I love the way they started it. It showed one of those screen things where the words would go down, talking about the King of Spain and the Emperor Charles and the Knights of St. John, and the Emperor had done some great favor, and so they wanted to return the favor by the yearly present. I think they deeded the island of Malta or something. Anyway, what did they... The favor was a falcon. Every year that the emperor would receive from this order, a falcon. But not that they wanted to do just a plain old bird falcon. They had a statuette about 40 inches high, encrusted with all the gems and diamonds and what have you at the time. And that became the gift. And history being history, there are long, long periods where the Maltese Falcon disappeared. It was put on a ship, pirates attacked it, and the pirates ran off with it, and then it was out of sight, and it surfaced. This was, you know, initially started in 1680 or something like that. And it started showing up again and again around 1850 or 1860 or 18, whatever it is, it showed up. But by then, it had been painted black to conceal its worth. And that's what the whole thing was about. Everybody wants to get their hands on the black, the black figurette, the Maltese Falcon. And so, as I say, there were so many code violations, I can't even remember all of them, but one of them evidently had to do with one of the three principals, Gladys George, who was a big star at the time. She almost disappeared in the movie itself. She was fooling around with Sam Spade, who was fooling around with her. And when you think about that, that's pretty awful. Then Sam is not your everyday clean-cut, all-American Superman-type detective. He kind of works on the edges. The law has him under suspicion and so forth. And so he's always kind of just pushing the barriers, pushing the envelope, as you might say. So it begins when this woman comes to his office and wants to talk about her sister, and they can't find her sister, and would you help? And she's fooling around with somebody named Floyd Thursby, and he's a very dangerous man. Oh, he has guns and all this stuff. You must be very careful. I know by his appearance, he's a violent man. And so all this happens, and Miles Archer, Sam Spade's partner, has come in and noticed this nice-looking lady, and his eyes roll, and he gets behind Sam Spade, and he locks his eyes on hers and gives her ogles her. I guess ogle is a good word, and smiles at her. And anyway, they agree that the best thing to do would be to have Miles tail this Thursby character. And so he goes off, and she, the good woman, Mary Astor, actually, is going to lead him to this character. So that's that. And the action never stops in this movie. Something's always happening. People are always double-dealing each other. If you want something with all these emotions going on and these shenanigans and what have you going on, this is for you, this movie. At any rate, Miles Archer goes out and she leads him to Thursby, but at some point Archer is shot and killed while he's obviously found this wicked Thursby character. And so then Sam is called, wakened in the middle of the night. He goes down. Lord Bond is there. He's one of the cops, one of the two cops that Spade gets along with. And he's explained, yeah, Sam, yeah, this, he got it in the pump with this Webley. They don't make these anymore, do they? Anyway, a Webley, and he's down the hill, and you want to go see him? And Sam said,
no, you've seen everything I could.
He seems to be accepting the death of his partner with such grace and such stolidity that it's kind of scary. And the next day, of course, the Mary Astor comes back in the office. And no, by this time, everybody knows that Miles Archer has been killed. And Sam reacts in kind of an unusual way. He tells Effie, the secretary, to take Miles Archer's name off the, take his desk out of here and his name off everything and have Samuel Spade put on. And so there. So when Mary Astor again shows up, she immediately assumes that Thursby has killed Miles Archer. It's a terrible thing. But now she is being chased by somebody. You never know exactly who's chasing who. But it goes from there, and they're all looking at who's got the Falcon, you know? Nobody has, as it turns out. And there's a triumvirate of the most interesting actors in the world, Peter Lorre and Sidney Greenstreet, who are on the lookout, on the chase for the Maltese Falcon. And Sidney Greenstreet, the fat man, he's called, and mentioned the fat man to Mary Astor and she turns white. But this is a black and white movie, so that's not much of a stretch. But anyway, Greenstreet has a gunsel, a hood, probably the most incompetent hood in movie history, because he keeps getting bested by Humphrey Bogart at every turn. It turns out that eventually all these people, after lots of activity, end up together, always trying to outsmart each other, and who's got the Falcon? Can you get it? How much is it going to cost? Lorre comes to Spade's office and offers him $5,000 for the Falcon. And of course, Sam Spade said, I haven't got it. And then, instead of giving him $5,000 or what have you, he gives him whips out a gun and says, I'm going to search your offices. And of course, Sam Spade knocks him out.
I have to make certain that you're not armed.
I should let every hood in town come in here and beat me up? Are you kidding me? No. And so, again, apologies finally all around, you know. And then as Lorre asks for his gun back, he gets the gun back and puts the stick to, you know, in Bogart's face again and says, I'm going to search your offices. And Sam laughs and says, go ahead. Because he hasn't got the Falcon. In fact, nobody at this point has the Falcon. They only know that it's coming somewhere. It's coming from Hong Kong. And there's lots of backstage stuff about what has happened to the Falcon. But Gutman has, in fact, been chasing the Falcon for 17 years. And Lorre is just another chaser of the blackbird, as is Mary Astor. And anyway, things proceed along, and the end game is to get a hold of the Falcon. And what happens, of course, is everybody double crosses everybody in this movie. Astor double crosses them. They're going to double cross Humphrey Bogart because Gutman and Bogart eventually meet, and he starts to tell him about the Falcon, and he tells him a little, but he won't tell him too much because Bogart won't tell anything about what he's doing. And so, we can't make a deal on these lines. And so they had two meetings at the last one. By this time, they know where the Falcon is and where it's coming from. And so they give Bogart a Mickey. And the Gunsel, who's been humiliated several times. Anyway, a lot goes on before the Falcon finally shows up. And this is about the time that, as I say, all the double crossing takes place. And Fade is double crossed. The Fat Man and Joel Cairo are double crossed. And then in all this, what's going on, because the people have been shot and killed, Thursby by now is pronounced dead. And so that, did he kill Archer? But who killed him? That kind of thing. And the police show up, Ward Bond and Barton McLean, who's always great as a cop. I can't tell you how good everybody is at their part. I mean, they live that part. Everybody in this thing was just stupendous. Anyhow, I don't want to go too far with this because it's already gone on too long, but it is a classic. It is the perfect film. It is amazing. And eventually, of course, Walter Houston, who's John Houston's father, staggers in, hands over the Falcon to Spade and Effie in the office, and then dies. Houston really he really pushed hard to direct the picture as well as write it. He had been a writer, and now he was going to direct. And initially, George Raft was going to be Sam Spade. But George Raft didn't want to work with a novice, a new, fresh, first-time director. So actually, Houston had enough clout with Jack Warner that they actually let Raft take a pass, and Bogart, the second choice, turned out to be the perfect choice. At any rate, the Falcon now has shown up, and eventually everybody is in the room together. By this time, Effie has the Falcon and brings it to the apartment where everybody's there. They've decided, this was Sam's idea, that the Fall Guy needed to be set up so that everybody could get away with what went on, because the cops are everywhere chasing us. Their noses are to the ground like bloodhounds, and we've got to be able to cover ourselves. So poor Wilmer, who has by this time been KO'd and is lying on a bed, even though Gutman kept saying,
"But I want you to know I couldn't be fonder of you if you were my own son." "Well, you lose a son, it's possible to get another. There's only one Maltese Falcon."
Anyhow, I won't tell you the end because it's a bit of a surprise. It shouldn't be, because that is a beautiful, beautiful ending. But the mystery of the Falcon is solved, but not in the way one would think. So Sam turns into being the good guy. The bad guys all are arrested. He's not part of the criminal element and didn't really, he didn't kill anybody. He didn't do this. Again, operating on the edges of the law, but anyway. So it's one of those things that it's so perfect, you just don't even want to see it again. I've seen it dozens of times. And it gets better every time I see new things in it. It is a movie classic, and if you get a chance, take a look, take a look. Third time is the charm. Third time for the Maltese Falcon was the movie of the year, maybe the movie of the decade.
Harry, what is it?
The stuff that dreams are made of.
Huh?
It was just the perfect film with the perfect cast, perfect director, perfect music, everything, you couldn't complain. It was just the greatest.